Hey everyone, in this video I'll show you step by step how to value any stock using the discounted cash flow model. A DCF model is the most popular valuation approach that famous investors like Warren Buffett use all the time. This model helps investors estimate a fair value of a company's stock by forecasting its future cash flows and discounting them back to the present. And I've already posted videos on valuing stocks using different formulas, such as the dividend discount model, Benjamin Graham's intrinsic value formula, the PE ratio, and the PEG ratio. So if you guys are interested in those videos as well, I'll link them in the description so you can check them out after this one. But for today's video and the DCF model, we'll be analyzing the stock price of Apple. I'll be using Excel, but you guys can also follow along in Google Sheets as well. I'll be plugging all the numbers for our calculations in the middle of the screen in a quick template that I created in 2 minutes, and I also pasted the formulas that we're gonna be using on the left side of the screen. And if you guys want, you can pause the video now and quickly recreate this template, and we'll be plugging the numbers together. So without any further ado, let's go through a DCF model together on my screen now. The first table that we'll need to fill out in our template is going to be the historical data table that's divided into 6 years, 2019, 2020, 2021, 22, 23, and 24. And we'll need to fill out two metrics, the free cash flows metric and the growth rate metric. And if you guys have never heard about the free cash flows, it's the cash that a company generates after accounting for its operating expenses and capital expenditures. In simpler terms, it's basically any cash that the company has left after paying for their expenses. And the free cash flow metric represents the money available to investors and is a key input in the DCF analysis. And we can easily find the free cash flow numbers of any major company online. So I'll go on Google and type Apple free cash flows. And then I'll click on the first link, which comes from macrotrends.net. And we'll scroll down. Let me just click off this ad. And you'll see the Apple annual free cash flow for all of its historical years. And now let's go back to the Excel and start typing the free cash flows for each year. So in 2019, it was 58,896. In 2020, it was 73,365. In 2021, it was 92,953. In 2022, it was 111,443. In 2023, it went down to 989,584. And in 2024, it was 108,807. So now that we have the free cash flows for all 6 years, we can calculate the growth rate of those cash flows. Let's start with 2020 and compare 2020 to 2019. So we'll start with an equal sign, choose 2020, divided by the 2019 number and minus 1. And we'll get 24.6% growth. So now we can click on this cell and drag the formula to all the future years as well. And you'll see that the free cash flow growth rate in 2021 was 26.7%, in 2022 it was 19.9%, then negative 10.6%, which went down, and then in 2024, it went up again by 9.3%. So now we're done with all our historical data inputs and we can move into the assumptions table. We'll start with the average historical growth rates of the free cash flows, which will help us estimate the future growth rate as well. So for this one, the only thing I'll need to do is start with an equal sign, type average, and select these 5 cells. And we'll see that the average free cash flow growth rate of past 6 years was 14%. And the next metric is one of the most, if not the most important inputs in our whole DCF analysis, and is the future growth rate of free cash flows. For this one, it's purely based on your assumptions of how much the free cash flows of Apple are going to increase in the future. One of the easiest ways would be to use the historical growth rate of 14% and just type it here. But in our case, let's try to be a bit more optimistic. So in 2020 and 2021, we saw that Apple's free cash flows were increasing by 24 and 26% each. What if we assume for our simple model today that in the next 5 years, Apple will be able to achieve the same growth rates again? So instead of using 14%, let's try to be a bit more optimistic and go with a higher number, maybe something like 24%. So by having 24% here, we're assuming the free cash flows will grow from 2025 to 2029, by 24% every single year. And now the next metric is gonna be the perpetual growth rate. And the perpetual growth rate is the rate at which a company's free cash flows are expected to grow beyond the forecast period. And because we're forecasting only up to 2029, and Apple as the company will exist well beyond that, we'll need to provide some sort of perpetual growth rate for Apple. And the conservative estimate of a company's perpetual growth rate is typically close to the long-term GDP growth rate of a country where the company is located. And because Apple is based out of the US, we'll use an average US GDP growth rate of about 2.5%. And now the only other metric left in our assumptions table is the discount rate. The discount rate is the required rate of return used to discount future cash flows back to the present value. It's often based on the weighted average cost of capital, and it reflects the risk of the investment. And for a stable company like Apple, the discount rate usually ranges between 7 to 10%, so let's use 8.5% for our table here. So now we're done with all the inputs needed for our assumptions table, and we're ready to populate our third table, which is the future forecast. And you'll notice that we have two lines, the future free cash flows from 2025 to 2029, and the present value of those future free cash flows. So let's start with the future free cash flows first. So for 2025 free cash flow forecast, we'll start with an equal sign in this cell. We'll select the 2024 number, which was 108 billion. We'll multiply it, open brackets, type 1 plus 24%. So we're basically growing the 2024 number by 24% to get the 2025 number. And let's protect the G11 cell, which is our future growth rate, because we'll need to use it for all the formulas here. Let's click enter. And for 2025, we get 134,921. Then for 2026, we're gonna use the same exact formula, but reference 2025 number. So we'll start with an equal sign, select the 2025, multiply it by 1 plus 24% growth rate, and let's protect the cell again. So we get 167,302, and let's drag the formula to all the years up to 2029. So by 2029, you will see that we're expecting the free cash flows of Apple to be at $319 billion, which can be quite high because of our 24%, but we'll go with the number. And now, because Apple will still exist as a company after 2029, we'll need to calculate something called a terminal value of Apple. And terminal value is the estimated value of a company beyond the forecast period. So terminal value is basically a single number that will tell us exactly how much free cash flows Apple will generate beyond 2029 in all of its future existence. And to calculate it, we'll be using the terminal value formula that I have on the left side of my screen. So let's start with an equal sign. The first thing we'll need to select is the FCF of year 5, so we'll select this cell. Multiply by, let's open the brackets, and it's going to be 1 plus G, and I'll select 1 plus G12. It's going to be the perpetual growth rate of 2.5%. Close the brackets, and we'll divide it by, let's open the brackets again, and it's going to be R minus G. R in this case is the discount rate, which is 8.5%, minus 2.5% again. We'll close the brackets, and we get 5.449264 as the terminal value of Apple. So now that we projected the future free cash flows for Apple for 2025, 26, 27, 28, and 29, basically the next 5 years, and then indefinitely as well using the terminal value, we'll need to bring those numbers back to the present value of future free cash flows. And we need to do that because the value of the future dollar is usually not the same as the present value of the dollar. And to calculate the present value of future free cash flows, we'll use the second formula that I have pasted on the left side of my screen, which is the PV of FCFs. So let's go to 2025. Let's start with an equal sign. Let's select the FCF of year 1 first. Let's divide it, and let's open the brackets, by 1 plus the discount rate, and let's put it into the power of 1, because the T is the time period, and we're in year 1 still. And you'll see that the value of future free cash flows in 2025 of 134 in today's dollars is 124 billion. So now let's go back to the formula and protect the discount rate, because we're gonna use the same formula for all the other cells, and we can drag it for all the other years and the terminal value too. And now you see that we have the present value of all the FCFs for all 5 years, including the terminal value as well. And for the terminal value, you'll notice that we had $5.5 trillion before, but now in present value, it's only $3.6 trillion. So it's a very important step to bring those future free cash flows to present value if you don't want to overestimate the value of the stock. So now that we're done with all the future forecasts, we can finally calculate the intrinsic value of the stock in our calculation table here. So the first metric that we'll need to calculate is going to be the enterprise value of Apple. And we have the formula here listed as enterprise value being equal to present value of FCFs plus present value of the terminal value. So it's going to be a very simple calculation because we have everything in our future forecast table. So we'll start with an equal sign, type sum, and we're going to select all the present values of future free cash flows. And we'll select the terminal value as well, the present value of the terminal value. Let's close the bracket. And we'll get the enterprise value for Apple as $4.45 trillion. So for the next section here, we'll need to calculate the net debt of Apple. And the formula for net debt is basically the total debt minus cash and cash equivalents. We can easily find all the numbers in Yahoo Finance for any company. And for Apple, let me just start typing whatever numbers I found in Yahoo Finance. So for the cash and cash equivalents, I found 65,171. For total debt, I found 106,629. And the net debt is going to be equal sign, total debt minus cash and cash equivalents. So we get the net debt as 41,458 for Apple. So now the next thing that we'll need to calculate is the equity value of Apple. And the formula for equity value is enterprise value minus net debt. So for us, it's going to be a simple calculation again because we have all the numbers. So I'll start with an equal sign, select the enterprise value, which is the first thing in the formula, and minus the 41 billion net debt. And we get the equity value of $4.4 trillion. So now that we calculated the equity value of Apple as a company overall, which is $4.4 trillion, we'll need to find out the intrinsic value of each stock. But first, we need to know how many stocks of Apple are out there. And for that, we'll need to populate the number of shares outstanding, which we can easily find on Yahoo Finance as well. So I went on Yahoo Finance and I saw that the number here is 15,020. So now we're finally ready to calculate the intrinsic value or fair value of Apple stock. So for that, we're gonna start with an equal sign. We'll select the equity value, which is 4.4 trillion, and divide it by total number of stocks that Apple has. And we get $293.55 as the fair value of Apple stock based on our assumptions. And the current value of the Apple stock as of today is $239.07. And in the upside downside, let's just compare the intrinsic value and the current stock price. So I'll start with an equal sign, intrinsic value divided by the stock price minus 1. And we'll see that buying Apple today has an upside of 22.8% based on our assumptions. And I know that some of our assumptions, like the future growth rate of Apple's free cash flows at 24%, was kind of too optimistic, but I just used it to show you how to calculate the DCF. You can adjust the assumptions with whatever you're comfortable with to be able to get your own true intrinsic value of any stock. So I hope you found this video helpful and now you're able to do your own DCF model by yourself. Thanks again for watching the video and I'll see you in the next one.